Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to the first annual UW Aero and Astro Capstone Film Festival. On behalf of the William E. Boeing Department of Aeronautics and Astronautics, we thank you for joining us to celebrate the creativity and hard work of the undergraduate class of 2020. It is our pleasure to introduce your host for this evening, fourth year doctoral student, recipient of a NASA Research Fellowship, founding member of the Aero and Astro CubeSat team, and co-host of the insightful and entertaining Paperboys podcast, Mr. Charlie Kelly.
Thank you, Ed. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the 2020 A&A Capstone Film Fest. For those of you who don't know me, after that glowing introduction, my name is Charlie Kelly. I'm a PhD student in the department, and I'm one of the mentors for the CubeSat Capstone project. If you don't recognize me, it's because I've gained about 10 pounds just in hair and beard during the quarantine. Obviously, these are unprecedented times, and it's strange to be convening this film festival while many of us are kind of sitting at home in our pajamas. But hopefully this provides a little bit more of a relaxed way for the Capstone teams to share their work with a larger audience. It's impossible for them to sum up the literally hundreds of hours of work that these seniors have put into their Capstone projects in just 3 minutes of video. But the films that will be shown today are impressive for doing just that. In some case, I would say they're even works of art, at least by engineering standards. So with that, I'd like to introduce the chair of the A&A department, Kristi Morgansen.
Students. Hello, graduating students. Sorry about that, we had a mute problem. I would like to start by saying how proud you should all be of yourselves and how proud I am of you for persevering during this time. And not just persevering, but doing so with innovation, grace, collaboration, and a positive attitude. We in the department would like to recognize what a moment this is for you. You have put in all of the effort and gained all of the skills to earn a degree from UW Aero and Astro. But we are temporarily prevented from all the normal celebrations of this moment. We heard you loud and clear. But you do not want a virtual proxy for a graduation. That was what was important for you, that what was important for you was the gathering together one last time as the class of 2020. We hope looking forward to March 27 will give you some solace and anticipation as we march toward the end of this year. We could not do anything together as we close the year, and here we are doing what engineers do, innovating. Thank you all for gathering here online for our A&A Capstone Film Fest. We know how difficult it was for many of the teams to go back to the drawing board multiple times with your sponsors and hammer out a new plan multiple times. We are looking forward to seeing how those plans move away from physical deliverables and live competitions to mathematical modeling, 3D printing, and positioning next year's competition participants in a much stronger position. We had to celebrate this. So please enjoy this time together, and this means to bring our sponsors, alumni, faculty, staff, and families to be with you now in this moment to celebrate your efforts, contributions, creativity, and innovations. I'd like to give special thanks and recognition to several people. First, thank you to Professor Susan Murphy and A&A's Whitney Thomas, who have worked so hard with all of the Capstone teams this year. I believe we also have some alumni joining us today. I'd like to offer a special note of thanks to our alumni judges panel for volunteering their time to determine the alumni's choice and honorable mention awards. These individuals will be judging the films on criteria such as accuracy, uniqueness, professionalism, and the potential impact these Capstone projects will have on our industry and society at large. The members of our judges panel include Heather Ross, Majud Maranci, Eric Mattson, Mike Taniguchi, Jim Teslow, Gita and Phil Condit, Rao Varanasi, and our 2020 Distinguished Alumni Reward recipient, Kuroj Hadi. Thank you all for volunteering your time to support this activity and our students. I would now like to introduce Rob Meyerson to make a few remarks. Rob is a very special friend of the department and dedicates a lot of time as a member of our visiting committee. We are so glad to have Rob here with us, and he has a few words to impart to the senior class. Rob, I pass it on to you and enjoy the film fest.
Thank you, Kristi. I'm super happy to be here and congratulations to all of you. Wish I could be there in person. We all do, but this is gonna be a lot of fun. The Capstone project is the culmination of it all. It's an opportunity for you to show off what you've learned and present your results to an interested audience. It's an opportunity to practice design and deliver a product that meets a set of requirements. It's an opportunity to work together on a team, breaking down the work, distributing it, and integrating the results together. And it's an opportunity for you to personally learn what works and what doesn't work for you. Now, doing all of this in extreme and challenging situations is an important skill, and you are learning those lessons in a big way. That's one of the silver linings that you can take away from quarantine this year. Another silver lining is the lesson in adaptability that you've undoubtedly learned this year. And to demonstrate this, I want to share a quote from Winston Churchill. It goes like this, quote, "Plans are of little importance, but planning is essential." And so my point is, once you know where you're going, you can always adapt and adjust your path to get yourself there. And trust me, you know, things never go as planned. This semester didn't go as planned, but this current state is not the new normal. We're in a time of significant change, unprecedented change, and we're all learning as we go. You will go out into the world and you're going to create the new normal. And I'm excited to see what you all make of it. Let me close my remarks with a word about the current state of the space industry. There was a time in my career, and I'm a little embarrassed to admit that I thought I'd missed the golden age of spaceflight. I look back on the Apollo and the space shuttle programs and dreamed of those accomplishments. Then I pulled my head back up, I shook it off, and I focused on the things that I had control over. Today, we have reusable rockets. We have a space force. We're on the cusp of flying people to the ISS from Florida tomorrow. Yay. Sending a lander and a helicopter to Mars this summer. Commercializing low Earth orbit and then going back to the moon. So there's no shortage of exciting challenges in the space industry and in the aerospace industry as a whole right now. And we're lucky to have all of you entering the workforce as our latest University of Washington grads. So thank you for having me here today. And I'm looking forward to this film festival. Thank you, Kristi.
Thank you for those words, Rob. So without further ado, it's time to get into some videos. Just a reminder to everyone, there will be a People's Choice Award to vote on after this. So you can find the ballot on the A&A homepage. It's also should be beneath each of the videos on YouTube or in one of the many emails from the department about this film fest. The ballot is open to anyone, not just people affiliated with UW. So we encourage everyone to vote on that. So first up, we have the Boeing Capstone Project, AKA Sakura Jet.
Hi, my name is Silas Chu, and I'd like to tell you about the Sakura Jet, a Boeing-sponsored capstone project involving the design of a 50 and 76-seat regional aircraft family. Our team consists of undergraduate seniors from the Department of Aeronautics and Astronautics at the University of Washington, and we're excited to show you the work that we've done. With air travel growing in affordability and demand, the growth of the regional jet market is predicted to be a staggering $105 billion over the next 20 years. Capturing this market would require a new state-of-the-art regional jet. This is where the Sakura Jet family comes in. The Sakura Jet will cater to airlines, passengers, and regulatory bodies alike by focusing on efficiency, passenger comfort, and safety. We began our design approach with a cabin, focusing on passenger comfort. So we began by including a 1.5-foot aisle and a 6-foot 10-inch stand-up height, comparable to the Mitsubishi Space Jet, which is renowned for its cabin comfort. All of this with plenty of overhead cabin space to fit large carry-on luggage. We also moved our cargo hold to the back of the aircraft rather than under the floor, like in competing aircraft, to create more ergonomic working conditions. We also verified the drag performance of each cross-sectional design with the conclusion that our ergonomic design created the least drag out of all of them. The wing-mounted engine design proved to be impressive in aerodynamic performance, as well as offered the capability to implement a trimmable horizontal tail, as opposed to a fuselage-mounted design. For the wing, our design process resulted in the highest lift-to-drag ratio over airfoils we tested while also having a large maximum lift coefficient. The final structural designs were verified under maximum loading condition through FEA, and the result is shown on the bottom left. Finally, our propulsive choice was the Pratt & Whitney geared turbofan family. The engines offer impressive thrust and low SFC figures, allowing for the required 20% fuel burn decrease in the 50-seater aircraft. With the potential growth of the regional jet market, the economic impact that this family of jets could have to grow the aerospace industry and influence the job growth across the U.S. would affect thousands of lives. The expansion of the regional jet market brings about a greater availability for transport to smaller airports at lower costs. Due to our innovative choices, we have designed a product that has improved fuel burn by 22% compared to the leading competitors in the 50-seater market, minimizing its environmental footprint. Since January of 2020, our team has been working together to create a regional jet family that satisfies our mission requirements. We would like to sincerely thank the people who made this educational experience possible. Our industry mentors, Gary Cohen, Jeff Hogan, and Matthew Orr. Our faculty mentor, Professor Livni, and supporting professors Alan Epstein and Professor Sultani. Thank you.
A great video from the Sakura Jet team. Their design is so good, it may entice me to actually set foot on an airplane again. So well done. Next up, we have the Airbus Capstone team with their urban mobility battery swap project. Well done, Airbus team. It's a very futuristic design. In fact, it's so futuristic, it automates human jobs that humans don't even have yet, which I didn't know was possible. The next video is from TLG Aerospace Capstone Group. So let's take a look.
We are the UW A&A TLG Capstone Group, and we have been studying 2D high-endurance airfoils that are resistant to contamination. Why is airfoil design so important? Beyond just airplanes, airfoils have many applications and are also used on helicopters, boats, race cars, and windmills. By improving on current designs to make contamination-resistant high-endurance airfoils, fuel costs and environmental impact can be significantly reduced. For example, over the last decade, fuel consumption has accounted for roughly 20 to 30% of airline expenditure worldwide. A major aspect of our design focus is to reduce the effects of contamination. Contamination can drastically reduce the performance of a wing, making an aircraft dangerous to fly and less efficient. In fact, a study showed that erosion, which consists of damage to an airfoil, can result in a 53% reduction in lift and a 314% increase in drag. This means there is a huge space for improvement in airfoil performance when contaminated that could lead to massive fuel savings or increases in efficiency. Our goal was to modify two existing airfoils provided to us to improve their endurance performance when contaminated. We followed two design pathways for each airfoil, CAD design and inverse design using X-foil. CAD design pathway consisted of adding only external modifications to an airfoil in SolidWorks. The goal of this design process was to come up with a cheap and easy modification that could be added to an existing wing to improve its performance, for example, by retrofitting a new leading edge. The inverse design pathway consisted of using X-foil to completely redesign the airfoils for better performance by modifying the pressure distribution and basic airfoil geometry. Our overall goal is to provide two possible modifications, a complete redesign of a wing, as well as a cheaper modification, both of which provide improved endurance when an airfoil is contaminated. For example, the 18% thickness inverse designed airfoil, called the 718, that we have currently developed has better endurance performance at high lift both when uncontaminated and contaminated compared to the original airfoil. The impact of this research extends to all corners of aerodynamics. More fuel-efficient aircraft are cheaper and have less impact on the environment, since aviation contributes 2.4% to all CO2 output worldwide. Reducing effects of contamination also makes planes safer, as it is dangerous to fly if the lift and drag of an aircraft are changing due to contamination without the pilot's knowledge. We can also improve the efficiency of airfoils used in applications such as propulsion or wind turbines. Understanding the effect of contamination on airfoils will also be very important for implementation of future high-altitude, long-endurance vehicles. Improving the endurance of contaminated airfoils is a very high-value problem that can potentially unlock huge improvements in safety and efficiency.
That was very informative. If you had asked me how to solve contaminated airfoils, I would have said to give it a power wash. So you should all be glad that we have a team like this working the problem instead. Next up, we have the Applewhite Aero team presenting the baton.
Hello. This is the Applewhite Aero team, and I'd like to introduce to you the baton. There is a current need in the market for a device that is capable of unmanned delivery to precise coordinates, but still remain affordable, and the Applewhite Aero team is working hard to make this a reality. Baton is a precision delivery drone that is not only flexible, but easy to use, portable, and durable. The coaxial motors are mounted on a custom two-axis gimbal to allow for rotation of up to 20 degrees in each direction, thus giving great control and maneuverability. This allows the baton to be nimble and react quickly to changing environments, making it possible for use in a wide variety of locations. The electronics bay is nice and compact, yet easily accessible to make any changes that are necessary, like connecting a receiver to trigger a camera, or for a speaker to call out its location or the name of its intended target. With integrated autopilot and connection with GPS and LiDAR systems, the baton can choose its optimal flight path and to land at its designated coordinates autonomously after being ejected from an aerial vehicle. This modular design of separate connectable airframes makes it quick and easy to swap batteries, change payload size, or configure the electronics bay as needed. This vehicle has many potential functions, but its primary motivation was to help military personnel receive the critical payloads that could potentially save their lives. The Bataan could be loaded with mission-critical tools or medical supplies in the payload bay that fits a standard 500-milliliter water bottle. Bataan fits a lot of potential into a compact and portable design. It is only about 2 feet long and weighs under 4 pounds. It is also capable of collapsing the payload bay using just 2 fingers to provide a 25% smaller footprint, making it easier to store. This could be vital for missions on smaller search craft or when needing a large number of them to create an array. With more time and resources, this product could be used for numerous functions. It could be used for missions to find lost people in difficult terrain without having to conduct costly organizational efforts that use up precious time. Or many units could be used to establish an array to set up perimeters for monitoring borders, or even to transport dangerous materials hands-free. The option is really up to you. From everyone here in the Applewhite Aero team, we hope you enjoyed this first look into an exciting new product, and we thank you very much for watching.
It's a very nice video. In addition to its military applications, the Applewhite team has very kindly offered me a prototype baton to shave my quarantine beard with. So thank you. The next video is near and dear to me. It is from the A&A CubeSat team capstone group. So let's have a look.
Hi everyone. We're the CubeSat Magnetorquer Control Team, part of the UW CubeSat team, which is made up of undergrads, grads, and doctoral students. Why is our stuff important? Well, has this ever happened to you? Oh no, my imaging satellite is out of position relative to the next target, and our reaction wheels won't spin any faster. Well, do we have a solution for you? Normally, we'd spin up these here reaction wheels in one direction, and due to the conservation of angular momentum, the rest of the satellite would receive the same momentum spinning in the opposite direction. Combining the torque from wheels along each of the three spatial axes allows satellites to point in whatever direction our clients want. The reaction wheels have to keep imparting and taking away angular momentum to keep pointing toward various targets while fighting off disturbances like the effects of orbital decay. But now, aw shucks, these reaction wheels are maxed out. It sure would be nice to have something to push against other than the craft itself, allowing us to slow down these reaction wheels without putting all that stored momentum back into the satellite. Well, how about Earth's magnetic field? That's right, with our not-at-all-patented magnetorquer technology, you can run an electrical current through a loop of wire, turning that wire into a mini-magnet that will try to align itself with the Earth's magnetic field. In doing so, the loop of wire exerts a torque on the spacecraft, which can be countered by the torque exerted on the craft by decelerating the reaction wheels so they're no longer at their maximum speed. The final product consists of magnetorquers embedded on the satellite's sides, a specially designed circuit board that takes signals from the satellite's main computer and translates them into electrical currents to flow through each magnetorquer, and finally, a special program on the main computer that allocates what signals and currents need to go to what magnetorquer to best desaturate the reaction wheels. This is our final design, complete with evenly spaced chips to disperse heat, along with connectors to each magnetorquer optimized for their relative positions on the satellite. Our circuit has to be ready to survive the harsh conditions of launch and space. We are following the qualification testing outlined in the CubeSat design specification document by Cal Poly. Our circuit will be subjected to a series of tests that will replicate the loads on the circuit as it orbits. We will be able to see how the circuit degrades over time, making sure that it will survive the mission and then some. The circuit will also be subjected to a series of tests that will heat the board to 175 degrees Celsius and down to negative 55 degrees repeatedly, mimicking the same temperature cycle our satellite will experience as it zooms around the world every hour and a half. We will also subject the board to the same vacuum it will experience in low Earth orbit. Finally, we'll need to make sure that the board will not only survive space, but also the violent rocket ride to get there. We have to verify that vibrational modes are above 100 Hz, since the most powerful launch vibrations lie under 100 Hz by exposing the board to frequencies from 0 to 2000 Hz. Craft that don't have our technology hooked up will max out their reaction wheel RPM and get stuck looking at one location on Earth per orbit, and there's a 70% chance that location's going to be water. You don't want your mission to fail, and neither do we. Call now for just 3 easy payments of $19.99. You'll get our full Magnetorquer control scheme outfitted on a satellite of your choice. And we'll throw in one of our nice mission patches for you.
That was a great infomercial. What the team didn't mention is that included with your order is a copy of the CubeSat's upper body routine and a month's supply of space protein shakes. Our next film is from the UW NASA Supersonic team. Let's have a look.
Today's airliners fly nonstop from London to New York in 8 hours. Yet 30 years ago, the same trip took just under 3 hours, cruising comfortably at twice the speed of sound. But none of the supersonic aircraft of the time, neither the European Concorde, the Russian Tupolev, nor the American HSCT, ever established a foothold in the commercial aviation industry. So why did they all disappear? For starters, they would have produced this massive boom along their entire flight path, raising significant concerns about noise and environmental pollution. Furthermore, the long, slender design of these supersonic craft had inherent performance and efficiency issues when operating in subsonic flight conditions such as takeoff and landing. The early supersonic commercial industry would be unable to surpass these technical and regulatory barriers. These obstacles heavily impeded the design of supersonic aircraft. Luckily, there are still people crazy enough to keep trying. We are the 2020 UW Supersonic Capstone Team, and we proudly present our research, which constitutes phase one of a 3-year NASA-sponsored, university-led initiative. Our ongoing objective is to study the low-speed performance characteristics of airplane designs that are representative of contemporary supersonic configurations. This research is primarily facilitated via the Kirsten Wind Tunnel, which has tested various civilian and military supersonic aircraft configurations over the years. The large test section of the wind tunnel provides valuable experimental data and flow visualization for a wide variety of low-speed flight conditions and design configurations. The 2015 model was selected from a wide variety of supersonic configurations and designs to be the foundation for 2020, given its resemblance to civilian commercial supersonic aircraft and its availability of the wind tunnel parts. Furthermore, the team wanted to further investigate the lateral stability anomalies visible during the 2015 flight test. The nacelles, outboard wing, leading edges, and tail assembly were all modified from the 2015 model with the goal of reducing the noise footprint and increasing its subsonic handling and efficiency, culminating to the final 2020 design. Low-speed, high-angle-of-attack flight conditions typical of takeoff and landing were rigorously evaluated in 4 computational fluid dynamic environments, DATCOM, STAR-CCM, XFLR-5, and X-Plane, after which full simulated flight tests were carried out. The exploration of the 2020 design has provided experimental and simulated data critical to addressing the low-speed issues endemic to supersonic configurations today. Future iterations of the design will continue to lay the groundwork required to build a fully certifiable reference supersonic concept. The time has come to accelerate the research, funding, and manufacturing of commercial supersonic aircraft so that we ourselves may accelerate into a fundamentally more interconnected and accessible future.
Very impressive work from the UW Supersonic team. When I asked the team how their project was going, they said, "We're doing 4 separate CFD analyses. How do you think it's going?" Next up is the perennial capstone staple, the Society for Advanced Rocket Propulsion.
The Society for Advanced Rocket Propulsion Capstone, or SARP, is an 18-member subgroup that comes from the larger RSO team of 150 undergraduate students committed to taking their engineering education to new heights through the design, manufacture, test, and launch of a 19-foot liquid bipropellant-sounding rocket named Pacific Impulse to compete in the 30K liquid hybrid category in the Spaceport America Cup competition in New Mexico.
SARP was on track to complete the development of Pacific Impulse before the COVID-19 outbreak, but was unable to complete manufacturing and testing due to facility closures and personnel safety concerns. As development had already passed the point where remote development would be viable, the team pivoted to supporting future research and development projects remotely for the betterment of the organization.
These projects range in their impact on the ongoing project, from aiding in design optimization to increasing performance margins, supplementing performance, and even increasing user-friendliness of the system.
The Composites Coupler team looks to decrease the structural weight of the rocket, increasing the apogee, or maximum launch height, of the rocket. The Area Roll Fin Can team looks to decrease the drag on the rocket by keeping a constant cross-sectional area perpendicular to oncoming flow, also increasing the apogee of the rocket. The Powderless Ejection team is working to increase the efficiency of testing and reliability of a recovery team's stage separators. The Ablative Heat Transfer Modeling team is looking at optimizing the amount of ablative thermal protection that is necessary on the rocket, decreasing overall rocket weight and system cost while increasing the apogee of the rocket. The Solid Rocket Booster team is working on adding additional total impulse to the current motor configuration and also hoping to get the rocket higher and higher.
Meanwhile, the Real-Time Operating System team is looking to make SARP's controllers more lightweight, draw less power, and improve the actuation timing for valves as the system increases in complexity. In addition, the Video Stream team is working to give the team live video of the launch from the rocket during flight.
Of these areas, the team started with system requirements and underwent multiple design iterations to produce analysis techniques, component designs, and or proof of concepts for future SARP teams to build from. Through this process, the team developed the best possible product for subsequent SARP launch vehicle improvement in each area, given the time allotted.
The project's primary benefactors are the student engineers that are able to grow technical and professional skills during their time on the team. All SARP members are encouraged to develop diverse skills. Members often spend their time on SARP spanning the roles of what would be design engineers, analysis engineers, manufacturing engineers, test engineers, and even project managers at real aerospace companies. These skills are highly coveted by industry professionals, sometimes to the point where they only seek candidates with similar project team experience. Additionally, SARP provides opportunities to be seen, network, and sustain communication with these industry sponsors and mentors.
SARP has been, and will continue to be, a critical part of the UW A&A engineering program. As shops open again and students return to campus, 2021 has the promise of being the best year for SARP yet.
It's unfortunate that their hardware work was limited by the quarantine, but I'd like to congratulate SARP on winning this year's award for the best non-backronym aerospace pun with Pacific Impulse. Our second to last film comes from the Vulcan Wildlife Conservation Drone Team. Let's see what they have.
As humanity develops, more and more of our wild planet has suffered. But what if we can use our technology to protect it instead? Vulcan's new wildlife conservation drone seeks to do just that. Elephants are not only the largest land animal in the world, but also have a larger temporal lobe than humans, the part of the brain associated with memory. However, these remarkable creatures are being hunted by poachers for the ivory in their tusks. It is estimated that only 415,000 elephants live on the African continent today, significantly decreased from the estimated 12 million that lived there 100 years ago. This decline is a result of the approximately 55 African elephants being illegally killed every day. The Vulcan conservation drone strives to protect the elephants and other animals currently endangered by identifying and surveilling poachers until they can be apprehended. The drone has a very simple mission. First, a ranger trap cam is activated from poacher activity. The rangers prepare and launch the drone in minutes. The drone flies from the command center to the area above the suspected target and circles until the target is spotted on the infrared camera on the craft. The drone tracks the suspects while the ground forces are directed to their location to apprehend. Once completed, the drone flies back to the command center and lands using the vertical takeoff feature. To increase the chances of catching poachers, the drone needs to stay in the air as long as possible, watching over the wildlife. Poachers are clever. But with this technology, drone surveillance will help crack down on poaching by tracking poachers and guiding the authorities. The poachers can then do some much-needed self-reflection behind bars, while the elephants and other endangered wildlife remain protected. Now we know our mission: increase the flight time of the drone as much as possible. To make the wing more efficient, we investigated over 100 wing taper configurations to find the best of the best. We have pushed the airframe to the limit to find the lightest structure without increasing the cost. We are using advanced computer modeling and simulation technology to decrease the drag of the aircraft. When we are finished, Vulcan's conservation drone should be able to fly for 5 hours, protecting the endangered animals that join us in calling this planet home.
It's a very noble cause. I actually reached out to the elephants for their thoughts on this life-saving technology, but unfortunately they declined to comment. Finally, we have a film from the Autonomous Rocket Control Club with their project Raven.
Landing a rocket is hard. But watch this. In recent years, this has become normal. It's inspiring. This is what the future of the space industry looks like. We want to get a head start on our careers. We are a group of students at the University of Washington in Seattle, studying aeronautics and astronautics. And we started a club. We're building a rocket. Raven is not like other rockets. Raven is small, cheap, and reusable. It won't go fast, high, or far, but it will help us learn to control rockets, keeping them upright and landing them softly. Its purpose is to be a testbed for students, allowing us to gain firsthand experience designing, manufacturing, and operating a rocket with reusability in mind. Raven is a hybrid rocket. Its engine uses solid fuel and liquid oxidizer. Hybrids are known for being relatively simple, reliable, and safe. Raven will use nitrous oxide as its oxidizer and 3D printed ABS plastic as its fuel. Raven also has a gimbal, which points the rocket engine, and compressed gas for small attitude adjustments. Our goal is for it to be able to lift off, sustain a hover for 15 seconds, and then land all under its own power and direction. We wanted to give ourselves an opportunity to explore our passions, make something we could be proud of, and participate in the cutting edge of spaceflight on our own scale. We're working hard to make Raven a reality, but we need your support. If you're interested in the work we're doing and want to support us, visit our website, Facebook, or LinkedIn page, or email us at arc@uw.edu. Until then,
Elon Musk had this piece of advice to offer the Raven team: hire a meteorologist. That was the last video, and so concludes our 2020 A&A Capstone Film Fest. I just want to say thank you to Rob Meyerson for speaking today. Thank you to the alumni judges panel, And thank you to Professor Murphy and Whitney Thomas for their work managing the whole Capstone program. Finally, thank you to all the A&A seniors for the work they put in, not only on these videos, but also the Capstone project as a whole, despite all the obstacles they've had to put up with this year. Don't forget to go vote on your favorite video to win the People's Choice Award. The link should be posted below the live stream, or you can find it on the A&A homepage. And thank you everyone for coming.